guessing this is on now. No, not yet. The door is closing and I think we're on. Hello everyone and welcome to the mini plenary in the first workshop block. I'm Wendy Dubo. I am the director. You can't hear me? Can you hear me now? Okay. I'm the Director of Strategies for Education Research and Evaluation at NCWIT, and I am here to introduce Dr. Amy Coe, who you see on the displays, and she will talk a little bit about why she's not physically here with us, which makes me sad that she's not here, but I understand completely. And let me tell you a little about her. So Amy Coe is a professor at the University of Washington Information School, and by courtesy, the Paul G. Allen School of Computer Science and Engineering. Dr. Coe started her career, I'll stand up because I know from before, you can't see behind the podium. Dr. Coe started her career examining where software failures and programming mistakes come from, and then addressing those with innovations in debugging technologies. Fast forward to the University of Washington, and Dr. Coe teaches and works with undergraduate and graduate students and conducts research on computing education, human-computer interaction, software engineering, and programming languages. Crossing disciplinary boundaries, her work and thinking draw from education research, learning sciences, and other social sciences that examine identity, community, and power. And in looking, I've known Amy Coe for a little while, but looking through her website, I loved, my favorite quote from there was, "Compilers can be mean," and she takes it seriously and tries to do something about that. Dr. Coe leads many initiatives, including a justice-centered pre-service CS teacher education pathway in UW's College of Education, and a statewide coalition of K-12 broadening participation in computing CS education advocates. Among other grants, she is on the leadership team of Access Computing, on the board of Exploring Computing Education Pathways, ESEP, both of which are NSF-funded broadening participation in computing alliances, BPC alliances, just like NCWIT is. And she's also co-director and founder of the new Center for Learning, Computing, and Imagination at UW. And so the format of this will be that Amy's going to give a talk, and then we'll have Q&A afterward, and I'll be sitting up here with her in spirit. Go ahead, Amy.
All right. Thank you so much, Wendy, for the introduction. I can't see the audience, but I can imagine the audience. I heard chatter. I heard there was a break too. So my mind is lit right now with all of the wonderful conversations you must have just had. So thank you so much for your attention while I share a bit and just offering me this time to speak. So I'm going to speak broadly today. Hopefully my talk title gives some of that away. But I think sometimes you're going to wonder a little bit what this has to do with women in technology. So I promise that if you listen closely, you will see the threads that I'm trying to pull together and that we'll have plenty of time to talk about them and disentangle them. So I'm really looking forward to that conversation afterwards. I'd like to just start by self-introducing myself. I'm Amy. I'm a professor. I study and teach computing information and computing education. Wendy already said all of those very formal and official things. So let me tell you the other things that are behind that, that I think are really important for establishing my positionality here. Like you and everyone else, I'm complicated. I'm a mom, a wife, a community organizer, a policy advocate, a youth volunteer, a software developer, an entrepreneur, an inventor, a writer. But I'm also a trans and queer and biracial person of color, and I like a lot of weird stuff like cats and tacos and puns and philosophy and economics and disorienting music and art that just drives other people mad and but makes me really happy when it surprises me. And I've just really started nerding out lately on micromobility, like strange little bicycles and scooters and other things to get around the city. All of those things inform how I think about the world. And they also inform how I think I am separate from the world sometimes too. So I want to unpack some of that. And as Wendy alluded to and is really obvious in that room, I'm not there. I'm joining from Seattle, from the University of Washington campus. This is my office. Our cherry blossoms recently bloomed. We just closed out a student employee strike. Our university president just resolved a negotiation with an encampment from the protests and the war in Gaza. So it's an interesting time on campus, but it's a time of spring that really makes me think a lot about just the natural beauty of campus too. It's one of the things I love about Seattle and the Pacific Northwest is that wherever I am, there's something naturally beautiful. On the quad, there's these rescued cherry blossoms. And down the street, there's an arboretum full of plants and trees from around the world. Over the hill, there's just a beautiful lake. And to the east, a mountain pass of hundreds of miles of trails and lakes and flora and fauna. And across the Snoqualmie Pass in the Cascade Range, there's beautiful desert plains of central and eastern Washington, full of apples and eggs and grapes and wheat and hundreds of rural communities that are thriving and connecting. And so this region's natural beauty is just this inescapable and unignorable thing. And it's why, if anything, the native peoples of this land settled here first, and why so many immigrants and refugees and transplants come to call this place home. People settle here because it's a beautiful place. But there are other reasons why people come here. There's one reason in particular. This is the Capitol building in Olympia, Washington. And this is where a lot of our state's work happens around policy. This is a building in which in recent years, we've made college largely free for families in poverty. We've taxed capital gains on billionaires to pay for schools. We've centered health equity and environmental justice in regulation of chemicals, pollution, noise, carbon. And all of that's in the backdrop of recommitments to things like being a refuge for people around the world fleeing war and violence, but also pursuing safety and opportunity. And it's also been a refuge for me as a queer and trans person in a country that's becoming increasingly hostile to me and to the trans youth that I teach and mentor and support, along with their families that support them as well. And so while Washington State is not perfect by any means, we're really far from achieving any real kind of equity, despite all of our incremental efforts. We are, relative to the country and the world, a place where people of all kinds can find basic respect, opportunities to thrive, and just a chance at progress, a chance at change. And I say all of this mostly to give contrast to where you sit in Kansas City, Missouri, and the differences in what it stands for. I've been to Missouri many times, Kansas City, St. Louis, many of its rural towns as part of vacation, as part of family visits, as part of professional trips to conferences and universities. And I've loved every visit. I love the food. I love the music. I love the urban fabric of its cities and all of the potential that it has for being a livable place. Everywhere I've gone in the state, especially when I used to present as a man, I felt welcomed and had a sense that everyone wanted it to be a great place and that they really cared about making it a wonderful place. But despite all of those visits, I don't really know Missouri. All I really know is what I observe at a distance. And most of that is what happens in its state legislature. So in case you haven't been following, here's what's happened. In this session, 44 bills in the State House and Senate this year, more than any other state in our union, all targeting trans youth and the people that care for them. And so I want to just read these to you, just so you have a sense of the kind of bills and legislation and policies that the elected representatives in the state are working towards. The state wants to define gender based on reproductive capacity, excluding people without capacity from law, and not just trans people, but you too, if you don't have that capacity. Wants to ban use of students' chosen pronouns and names in school. Wants to ban gender-affirming care permanently, not just for youth, but for adults. It wants to force teachers to out queer and trans students to parents and guardians. It makes female impersonation, which I'm doing right now on stage, around children a felony, effectively banning trans teachers. It bans public restroom use by all trans people, bans public funding of organizations that support trans people, bans public retirement systems from investing in organizations that support trans people. It shields transphobic students, teachers, and faculty, i.e. bullies, from discrimination lawsuits. Bans trans students from school sports. This one's actually passed last year, but this would make it permanent. It defines all government IDs of trans people as fraudulent, meaning that if that had passed, it wouldn't have been able to fly home from the state of Missouri. It bans healthcare education. It requires learning about gender-affirming care. It bans state from educating people about diversity. It makes teachers, counselors, and doctors offering gender-affirming care a felony. It bans teachers teaching on gender identity and sexual orientation in schools. And they want to ban hiring and promotion processes from requiring writing about diversity, equity, and inclusion. So that's 44 bills in a state legislative session this year that had about 60 bills. 75% of the bills that representatives brought to this legislature were about creating this future. And I have good news, because the session ended on Friday. None of them passed, which is, I guess, something to celebrate. It's like, yay, not more harm. But it's not because they didn't have support. It was really only due to a session of GOP hostility and disarray and infighting and dysfunction that prevented these and countless other bills in the session from passing this year, along with really intense local organizing by trans rights activists to create so much noise that the right decided to prioritize other things, like just barely passing a budget and some school Medicare and farming subsidy. The damage is already done. Last year, Missouri passed a bill penalizing schools by cutting funding if they acknowledge the existence of trans youth. They banned trans kids from playing sports. They banned healthcare for trans youth. And all of that in the past year has created tens of thousands of trans refugees in Missouri, severely impacting youth mental health, and partly led to many teachers leaving K-12 schools in the state, but also leaving the state in general to teach elsewhere. And this is the exact problem that the increased funding in education bill that passed this year is trying to address. Most of the legislatures that started these bills over the weekend released press releases saying that they vowed to bring all of these bills back in the next session. So this is not done. And if the right takes the White House, the Senate, and the House at the federal level in November on this election, expect them to keep their promise. And so this vision of Missouri's legislative majority and a substantial proportion of its voting public is one where trans youth can't be in school, can't be in public, are not supported, and are erased from law. It is a demand by government to disappear, to go back into the closet, to be less free, and indirectly an encouragement to take our own lives. It's a future where I can't go, I can't teach, I can't speak, I can't advocate, I can't exist. And so this vision, funded by Christian nationalist billionaires, it's a disinformation campaign of lies and social media amplification and exploitation of minority rule in service of keeping power. It's at the expense of our most vulnerable youth, including girls, boys, non-binary youth, disabled youth, neurodivergent youth, Black, Asian, Hispanic, Indigenous youth, and every imaginable kind of teacher who either shares those identities or doesn't want to teach in a state that would commit such violence against its children. So for me, it's kind of hard to describe this as anything but genocide. And it's not hypothetical. Trans people in Missouri in the past year, since these bills have passed, including many trans youth, have been regularly killed in prisons, in cities on the streets and suburbs, by Missouri citizens, by the police, and by the state. The laws that passed in the last year, they're only gonna lead to more deaths, and the laws that will pass to come will only do the same. So as you can imagine, that's not really a world that I want. Certainly not a world that trans youth I work with want. It's probably not a world that you want. Certainly not a world that teachers and school leaders and doctors and nurses and therapists and parents or siblings want for the trans youth they support either. I hope that everybody in this room can agree with that. But this is not a talk about death. This is a talk about liberation. And I think this is the time to really point out that focusing on the constant assault on our kids at the expense of creating the world that we actually want, as opposed to defending a status quo that doesn't work for them anyway, that's not really a way to create the future. And so talking about the world that we want, that's something that we need to give our time to, as much as we also need to fight when people are attacking us. So if we want a world that represents and serves everyone, we have to take the word everyone seriously. And so what I want to try to do in the rest of this talk is share what I mean by everyone by sharing some of the stories of youth and teachers that I've encountered in my volunteer work and in their lives, I don't want to share their exact stories, though, because I don't want to disclose their identities. I don't want to make their stories visible to everyone in plain sight. So what I'm going to do here is share mashups of their lives together. So I'm going to vigorously mix elements of the things that are in their lives into new stories, stories that are true and realistic in the sense that they have elements of all of the lives of the real people that I've worked with, but hopefully don't disclose anything. So I've checked with all of the youth that I've talked to about these things, and they're okay with all of these mashups that I've created. So what does everyone mean? Let's talk about a few examples. Everyone means a 14-year-old non-binary student I talked to online on Zoom in a trans group, youth group that I run, and they were calling from Arkansas, and they were whispering from their closet so that their parents wouldn't hear them. And they'd been bullied pretty badly in school, and the school hadn't done anything about it, so they stopped going. And their parents didn't know that they were trans, but they really couldn't take the abuse any longer at school, and so they'd started acting out a lot, and their dad had threatened to kick them out of the house unless they'd straightened out, and they were coming to the group to just look for some guidance on how to get support around the bullying that was happening. But there were other things that they wanted too. They didn't just want to flee that violence. They were autistic, and they liked to program Minecraft worlds to share with their friends. They dream of moving to Brazil, which they learned recently passed some of the most trans-affirming legal protections in the world, including free gender-affirming care as part of the national healthcare system. And they want a future where they can create and make friends and be well and be loved and be safe. That's their dream. Everyone also means the 11-year-old boy I met from Eastern Washington. He's trans, he likes his pet hamster, he likes to have pictures of animals in socially awkward situations, and he wanted to take a coding course at his middle school to learn how to make digital hamster art, but he also uses a wheelchair, and his wheelchair doesn't fit under the desks in the school's computer labs, so he just decided to stick to hand illustrations at home because he couldn't be in the classroom at school. And he wondered if he made the journey to Seattle, just a few hours away, to our youth center's house, if he could do a class there someday. And I had to tell him, unfortunately, the computer lab is upstairs and there's no elevator. But we could bring a computer down to the living room and do a class in the living room someday. And so he just wants a school with accessible classrooms so he can make his weird hamster art. Everyone means the Black trans man, age 21, coming to the group looking for community with other Black trans men in college, not constantly getting flagged on dating apps and discords as a fraud, and free to roam the streets in his city without worrying about police violence. He wondered if we had any tips on how to find private supportive communities online, free of harassment and hate speech and racism. And the rest of our group that night, mostly young white adolescents, wasn't there for him. He was studying political science and information diffusion and really dreamed of a career of doing social network analysis to study bias. Everyone also means the 14-year-old Ukrainian refugee that I met, recently blind from an IED explosion last year set by Russian troops outside her home. She was an English learner, and she was trying to learn how to use screen readers, but her school didn't have the knowledge to help her. None of the teachers had knowledge of screen readers. And she missed her dumplings in Ukraine and found some recipes online, but the screen readers supported at the public library and local refugee resettlement not-for-profit that she used, they wouldn't accurately read Ukrainian to her, and so she couldn't have the screen reader read any of these dumpling recipes. So she wanted to learn how to train a speech synthesis model, language processing model on Ukrainian so she could read the recipes and share them with others who could help her make them. And she wasn't out to her parents, but she was out to some of her teachers because some of them had trans pride flags in their classrooms. She doesn't really know what she wants other than to be settled after immigrating, to have friends and to find ways of staying connected to her Ukrainian culture and to share it with the people in her life. Everyone also means the non-binary art teacher at a private school in Seattle trying to create safe spaces for their students' self-expression. They had one student who wanted to create interactive art and were asking me for tips on how to teach coding in their art class and if I knew of any professional development opportunities that focused on art. The principal had been misgendering them for years and seemed to be threatening to ban them from using their gendered restrooms, which would have been a violation of state law. And we're also wondering if I knew of any schools that had more trans-affirming leadership and needed an art teacher. They wanted a place where they could teach and empower youth to express themselves through interactive art and not have to worry about being safe in their workplace. And everyone means scholars and activists like me being able to join you in places like Missouri without facing felony charges for being a female impersonator engaged in adult cabaret performance, using the gendered restrooms and trying to use my fraudulent driver's license to return home on a flight. It means being able to be there with you in person, to have rich conversations over dinner, to imagine how our coalitions might be able to build the future these youth and teachers dream of. It means not being mired down by the heaviness of civil rights laws, but instead working together to create joyful spaces where youth and teachers and advocates that support them can imagine liberatory futures of computing together. And everyone means you, who will inevitably be ensnared by this nationwide legislation too, either because you are queer, trans, gender nonconforming, or because people will assume that you are based on how you look or dress or behave. In fact, many cis people in Missouri have already been harassed in restrooms and schools, even by elected representatives in the state legislature of Missouri, for not conforming to 21st century conservative gender norms. You can't do good work to broaden participation in computing if you're being harassed because you don't fit into some arbitrary box of gender presentation. So I'm sure you have dreams of a freer world as well. One where you can dress how you like, speak how you like, teach what you want, have basic respect, celebrate your cultures and communities. These are the same things that our youth and teachers want. That liberatory future is something that we share in common. So how do we build that future? I want to spend a little bit of time just talking about what that future might mean and some of the unconventional things that it might entail that we don't usually talk about in technology spaces. And I want to acknowledge that part of that is resisting hateful legislation. We can't ignore that these things are happening. We have to fund lawsuits against all of these unconstitutional bills. We have to make sure that they do not become part of normal human existence in the United States of America. But even if we're not free to be free of all of that harassment and violence and imprisonment, it's going to be really hard to collaborate if we don't also have a shared vision of what it means to make a world for everyone. And so it's really a question of, do we have the will together to try to think about the reinvention that's required to try to build that freer world for all of us? Reinventing our systems, reinventing our culture, reinventing our communities and the work that we do together. And so here's five things that I think we might think about when we think about technology and broadening participation and trying to do all of this reinvention. So here's number one. We have to empower and resource those on the margins of computing to lead change. And this is a hard conversation to have because I know that we have a lot of leaders that may not view themselves on the margin. Or maybe they view themselves on the margin in some ways, but not in the ways that we might want to make progress on. And it's a lot to ask to have people step down from power and give that power to somebody else, but sometimes that's what's required. And so I want you to sort of reckon with, deep down in your soul, with what work you're positioned to do. How are you marginalized in computing? What are the limits of your knowledge and lived experience? Who has knowledge that you don't have? None of us knows everything about the world that we need to make together, because none of us are marginalized in all possible ways, and that includes me. And so paying close attention to who's leading our work, who we ask to lead our work, how we resource them to do that work, what knowledge is missing from our leadership, that's essential. Thinking about how we structure that power as well to make sure that even if we don't have leaders in every position that are doing that work to create that freer world, that we find ways of including marginalized viewpoints at the center of our priorities, not at the margins of our priorities. That is an unquestionable priority in trying to do this work. Another challenge here, and you know, this is something that it's not just me saying, but hopefully you're hearing this from others as well. As you heard in some of the stories I shared, there is no way to create computing education that works for everyone if schools in general are not working for everyone. We need accessible schools for students with disabilities, schools that support all of the language fluencies that students bring to the classroom, schools that have sufficient resources to do the teaching and education that we're asking them to do, protection for youth from abusive parents and peers. This has to happen in every single classroom in the United States, and we can't do the kind of computing education that we're imagining if we don't have all of those other essential resources in schools. So we have to partner with nationwide efforts for equitable public education. We have to think about the broader efforts of STEM education that are part of those broader partnerships, and we have to think about education in general. So finding ways to coordinate our work is essential. Otherwise, we do things that are too piecemeal and sometimes in conflict with those broader priorities. Now, I know that sounds really hard, and it is, and I'm not offering any clear solutions here, but it does mean really thinking about what are our goals and what are the essential things that we need to achieve them. Here's another hard one. Youth who are not healthy and are not well or are depressed or are suicidal because of the things that are happening in their lives can't learn computing. They can't learn technology. These are not things that are going to be possible if you don't have basic needs met in your life. Teachers who are banned from working because of their identity, they can't teach computing. Youth and teachers with disabilities who can't access classrooms, computers, computing itself, they can't create this future with us, and we can't create one that includes them without them. And so including these connections to broader visions of an equitable United States in general, not just schools, that means really thinking about things like health and employment and disability. These are essential resources for trying to make the kind of broadening participation that we're imagining possible. Here's another one that I often don't hear in our discourse. There are a lot of youth that can learn a lot of things about computing without computers, but there is a lot that they cannot. And more than 40% of youth in America don't have devices or stable internet access. And while public schools and libraries can bridge some of these gaps in some ways, they are far from sufficiently funded to be able to bridge all of it, particularly when youth are at home, and particularly when the learning we're asking students to do is at home. So we have to meaningfully link equitable computing education efforts to internet rights efforts, to digital divide efforts. And that means asking really hard questions about funding and infrastructure and sustainability and all of the politics that obstruct these needs. We can't really do the future that we imagine without doing these partnerships as well. And then lastly, this is not all we need, but certainly the last one in my list. Youth can't learn in classrooms or in schools in general if they do not feel physically or emotionally safe around their peers and teachers. Safety is a fundamental resource. It is a promise we make to children that is too often broken because we do not take it seriously or we do not resource known solutions. And as we all know, many computing classrooms are places with all kinds of students that do not feel safe with teachers, or with the white and Asian cis straight boys that are around them who tend to take up those spaces. I was talking to a teen just on Saturday. They were throwing a queer pink prom, and one of them was talking about their computer science class that they were in and how she'd made some friends over the first couple of months of the class. And then she got a group chat from them just that Saturday morning saying that she was too queer and too fat to be friends. That's the kind of bullying stuff that just happens in schools. It just happens in middle schools and in high schools. It happens in our computer science classes. And those are not safe spaces for youth to be. If we can't make them that way, then it's not possible to create the futures that we're trying to imagine. So what does any of this have to do with computing? Well, computing isn't merely a subject area to add to an already full curricula. All of the schools in our nation are struggling with constant requests to add things. But I believe that computing can be a source of transformation in the things that we do in schools. It is a disciplinary context that's unencumbered by 100 years of stale pedagogy and warped parent expectations and broken infrastructure and dated curricula. And not only that, it's a place of creativity and community building when we make it that way. It can be a place of multiculturalism and ability diverse celebration when we make it that way. And so if we can show what kinds of learning are possible in schools by harnessing this rare moment of educational transformation, We might not only transform computing education in schools and broaden participation in it, but we might also transform education more broadly too. Imagine, for example, that we created computer science classrooms that really did work for everyone in all of the ways that I've talked about here. How would that make our math teachers and our physics teachers and our language arts and social studies teachers reimagine what they might do in their classrooms too? So how do we do this? I am hardly the person to ask. I mean, I know a lot of things and I talk about a lot of stuff, but I don't feel like I truly lead in these visions. I want to point you to the work of some others who I do think are leading in some of these and just try to show you some of the worlds that they're imagining and how they're trying to realize those worlds. And then I'll end with some of the worlds that we're imagining at the University of Washington. So I want you to pay attention to the work of Rick Rose Roque at the University of Colorado, who's really imagining learning spaces that do this radical thing of acknowledging that youth and their families are inseparable. Centering family, family relationships, family learning, and the myriad ways that love and identity and culture and language and creating interplay with each other. Her work not just points to not just liberatory futures, but ones where youth and their families can actually not just learn, but find joy together. And in those moments of joy, find opportunities for learning and transformation. I want you to look to the work of Sepehr Vakil, who imagines futures of computing literacy that weave together youth's political identity, engaging them in wrestling with the power of and culture and civil rights questions at the heart of computing, but in the context of engineering, because engineering is a center of power in the world, whether we like it or not, but also because of its commitment to making and realizing our imagined futures as a discipline. It is a discipline that thinks about change and creation and reinvention. Listen to Yolanda Rankin, who's leading intersectional inquiries into the many ways that identity and culture and spirituality interact to shape learning and teaching and computing, along with her collaborators Sheena Arit and Jaquita Thomas. This is the work that's showing us what it means to connect all of the things that we talk about now to all of the things that we don't talk about in schools and in families that really are part of trying to make broadening participation work. I want you to learn from my colleague, my new colleague, Ben Shapiro, who just started at the University of Washington, who's trying to imagine computing literacy as something emerging from families going deep into the heart of data and algorithms and AI, really understanding how it beats and pumps and brings computing to life, helping them to try to imagine futures that aren't just about meeting some learning standard, but about meeting their own needs in their families and communities and their families' needs and the needs of their broader world. These are the kinds of empowering applications of computing and computing literacy that I think are part of the visions that we're trying to create around liberation. They're part of those stories that I shared with a lot of the trans youth that I was talking about, thinking about how they could harness computing for the problems that they experience in their lives. And I want you to study Jean Yu's work, which examines liberatory futures in classrooms and how youth and teachers can work together to imagine those futures together and deconstruct ideas like responsible and social and what those actually mean in culturally responsive terms and in political terms that connect to the broader structures of teacher education and school policy and leadership. These are the scholars that I see that are telling us where to go and what to pay attention to, and they're the ones I'm paying attention to. It's their leading voices that are showing us the futures that we need to build. And so I'm doing my part by listening closely to them, but also by trying to prepare and support future leaders to do the same. And so I want to tell you about some of the students and postdocs that I'm working with whose visions of the future I'm really excited about too. This is Max Gordinsky. He's my new postdoc who just started this year. He's examining the worlds that queer and trans teachers on the margins of computer science have created for themselves and for their students in the absence of personal and professional community and in the presence of ongoing exclusion, informally and formally by the state and their communities. So what's really powerful about the ideas that he's examining are just the ways that when the world doesn't support you, how people react to that, how teachers react to that by creating new worlds of their own. And so understanding what those worlds are, that's the powerful thing that Max is exploring. I'm excited about my PhD student Jane Everson's work, who's examining the myriad ways that deconstructing and co-constructing classroom spaces with youth can free youth to find themselves and their futures, partly through the materiality of making, but also by linking computation to all of the physical things that youth might care about in their lives, whether it's their clothing or their shoes or their family histories that they're just digging into as adolescents. And so Jane is doing this amazing work to think about how to teach in ways that just dismantle schools themselves inside the classroom, even as the school around is still intact, and trying to find spaces where youth can be free in those spaces to explore. My PhD student, Mara Kirdani-Ryan, they're just finishing up the film in a couple of weeks. They're deeply examining how to create cultures and communities in computing learning spaces that center things like love and identity work and liberation and freeing individuals and groups from the constraints of social norms and family systems and academic epistemologies. And I think what's really powerful about their work, you can't read it because peer reviewers don't find it scientific enough, is really the way that all of their questions and their investigations around culture really examine how it is that we create culture in computer science and how it is we can recreate it too when we help youth feel free to question all of the norms that we've constructed in computer science. I'm looking to my PhD student, Rodin Landesman, who's really discovering ways to help youth what Safer calls philosophers of technology, help them become those philosophers by really trying to deeply link computing and philosophical argumentation skills to help students reason through what are their notions of fairness and justice and equity. How are those connected to their family relationships? How are they connected to their politics? And how are they connected to how they view futures of computing as well? My PhD student, Megumi Kavuva, is doing amazing work weaving together the liberatory dreams of refugee and immigrant youth who come to Seattle for refuge, and trying to think about ways to connect language and culture and first homes with the expressive possibilities of programmable media. And what they're finding is that when youth find those opportunities, they have so much to say. And it's really just about creating places, spaces and media for them to say those things. And so I'm really excited to see their work unfold as we start to hear the voices of all of the refugee and immigrant youth who haven't really been given a platform to speak. Just a couple more, I promise. My PhD student, Iman Sharif, she's doing this fascinating work examining the dreams that Black students have in higher education for how teaching and learning and assessment might be designed differently to center liberatory tools to empower students to create computing education contexts that are free of racism, but also free in all of the other kinds of ways that we think about accessibility and language and culture. And so some of her work, a paper just published, for example, at the ACMI conference for this August, is looking at questions around how do the assessment policies we create end up playing hegemonic roles in making it impossible for students on the margins in CS to thrive? And what does it mean to design assessment policies that are free of some of those hegemonic ideas? And then I have lots of undergrads. I'll highlight two here, Isabel and Rayana. These emerging leaders are really trying to help imagine with me what it means to create open source communities that create and maintain learning technologies for computer science education that are justice-centered, and what that would mean, and what that would mean especially in terms of sharing power. How do we create spaces where a sixth grader, for example, feels free to share their mind, their ideas and their visions for what a platform should be in a room where their teacher is, and where fancy, powerful researchers are and PhD students are hanging out? What would empower them to really make sure that their voices are the ones that are leading the programming languages and technologies that we create for learning? And then the last group, of course, are the teachers. These are leaders, including more than 30 teachers who joined our STEP CS K-12 CS Education pre-service pathway here at the University of Washington. They are leading in how they think about what computing means in the rest of schools. how computing combines with language arts, with social studies, with mathematics, with science, with art, in middle schools and high schools, not just in Western Washington, but many of them are moving across the country to all kinds of places, and trying to find ways of creating classrooms that respond to and sustain the complex racial tapestry of the Puget Sound's white, Asian, Hispanic, and Native communities, along with the thousands of refugee and immigrant families from around the world who bring all of the world's cultures to our region. They're tackling this work day to day in their classrooms and staying in contact with each other and with us, forming a powerful network of mutual learning around what it means to create schools that imagine some of these liberatory futures. We do all of this work on campus, faculty, postdocs, and students in our new Center for Learning, Computing, and Imagination, where we're trying to bring together all of these different voices across disciplines, across institutions, outside of the university and inside of it, to try to understand how learning about and with computing through the lens of imagination can transform not only individual lives, but communities and schools and systems and society. So, how about you? What can you do? I honestly don't know, and that's because I'm not you. But you can ask yourself this question. Who are you? What do you bring to this work? Who can you partner with? Is the work that you're doing now leading towards these liberatory futures of computing literacy? And if not, what can you stop and what can you start doing? I'm happy to be here with you to think and brainstorm in conversation and try to imagine how we can be free together to try to imagine those futures of computing that might just work for everyone. Thanks.
Thank you, Amy.
I'm imagining applause now.
Yeah, there was applause. I inadvertently started applauding with the mic in my hand, so sorry about that, everyone. we are going to move to Q&A, but while people are sort of gathering their thoughts, and we have Edie Chang from NCWIT who's going to run around with a mic kindly for us, because Amy can only hear what comes through the mic right now. But I'll start us off with a question, just to let people have a minute. So I don't know if you were able to hear Dr. Aaron Seck's opening plenary that was streamed, but one of the things, I know you're familiar with her work probably though, and so one of the things that she talked about was one of the ideologies pervading engineering and computer science is depoliticization, and this idea that, you know, there are certain there's ideology that you wouldn't talk about certain things within this technical discipline, that it's somehow separate from it. And so I'm wondering what you say to folks either in academia or in industry who are, you know, focused on computer science and think that talking about gender or other minoritized identities doesn't have a place in computing?
Yeah, it's a great question. And what I like about that question is it just goes to the heart of really what the barriers are to creating all of these futures that we're trying to imagine. I think with that word in particular, politics, politicization, we've often just forgotten what politics means as a word. It means conflict around people, disagreements around people, how we reconcile those disagreements around people. And so what you're saying when you say you don't want politics in the classroom is you don't want the conflicts that are present in the classroom to be resolved. And that's all that means. And so let's imagine what all of the conflicts are that we don't want to be resolved. So someone in the classroom feels like they are not welcome because they're not sure they're safe there because of their identity. That is a conflict a student is experiencing. Someone who says we do not resolve those conflicts in this classroom means that they're saying they don't get to be there in that classroom. They must experience that discomfort of not feeling safe. I was just talking to one youth last night, my trans group is on Mondays with youth, and he was stealth, that's the word we use in trans communities, just being trans, but passing and people not knowing that you're trans. And he was just saying, like, it's getting uncomfortable to not be able to tell people, and he wants to tell people, and he didn't know if it was safe to tell people. And he was just asking the other youth in the group, like, have you told people? Was it okay? Did bad things happen? And everybody was honest. Some people said, well, things were fine in my school. I don't know if they'd be fine in your school. Other students said that they were bullied and physically abused by their peers for 5 years. And so what it means to say, let's take politics out, is to say, we don't talk about any of that bullying that's happening. We don't talk about what it means to make people safe. We don't talk about identities on the margins that maybe don't have the resources or support or love that they need in their places of learning to learn. That's what it means.
Thanks. Other questions from the audience?
Hi, Amy. Margaret Burnett. As always, thank you for the wonderful talk. I always learn something when I listen to you talk. I have a new question for you. Can you hear me, Amy? Oh, awesome.
I can.
Okay, good. I have a new question for you. So I was just inspired by a talk by Kate Crawford, the author of Atlas of AI. And in that talk, she was talking about the huge resource costs to the planet and to, you know, people who are actually slaves digging up minerals and all of these things with from AI in general. And of course, we know now even more so with LLMs, because they are particularly resource hogs in a world of resource hogs. And also how using them is kind of helping to centralize the power with the billionaires who sort of have access to all this stuff. So I'd like to put a proposal to you and see if you agree or disagree or something. So here's the proposal. I propose that people who are kind of getting on the bandwagon and trying LLMs with whatever their favorite thing is, consider, if they're already on that bandwagon, okay, finish their current project, and then use that as a baseline to compare against achieving the same thing without LLMs, or maybe even without AI, and then publish that to see if they can do the same thing and do some sort of resource analysis to show what they saved by doing that thing. And so I'm proposing that because I'm thinking it's a way to maybe stop all this concentration of power. I don't know. What are your thoughts on it? Good, bad, middle, all around?
Yeah, and just for context for everybody in the room, Margaret and I know each other because Margaret was my undergraduate research mentor at Oregon State way back in the late 90s. And so, like, there's context in this conversation, and I'm thinking about a lot of other conversations that Margaret and I have had too. I think the key thing I want to really grab onto from your question is this concentration of power question. But it's also something that you didn't say, which I think was also present in what you were talking about, which is, what are LLMs for? Nobody asked for them, right? This isn't something where we had some nationwide thing where it's like, we got to make this vaccine so that we don't die from a global pandemic. It was just like, well, we could do this, and sci-fi has talked about it, so let's make it. And so at the heart of this question of concentration of power is like the lack of interest in application for a lot of people who are working on LLMs. It's not really about solving any particular problem in the world or helping anybody in particular. It's just about making it because we can. And then you get the sort of snake eating itself problem of for-profit industry, which is, we have to make LLMs better because they are our next opportunity for revenue. And they're our next opportunity for revenue, and so we have to make LLMs better. And then we get in this little cycle here, too. And so all of this, to me, just feels like distraction, right? So if I was going to design a different study around LLMs, like the one that you were proposing, well, I would say, well, try to figure out what we should be using them for. Where would they actually help create this future that we're trying to imagine together? And as we're trying to reconcile all of the different tensions in these futures that we're imagining, is there a role for something that mostly gives answers that are highly normative and like converge towards central tendency and kind of ignore the margins and are really, really good at getting very common probable things right and really, really bad at getting things that are uncommon right? What does it mean to emphasize a technology that has those properties? And then, of course, like, you have to ask the sustainability question as well, because those 5 points that I was making in this talk about what we might have to do to build the future that we're trying to imagine, tying to health and wellness and sustainability and education and all of these other broader systems that we're working towards, none of this matters if we don't have energy. None of this matters if we can't live where we live now because there's water there now, or there's smoke there now, or it's too hot to survive on the planet. And so we have to be paying attention to those things. So I don't know, maybe ask why a little bit more. That's what I'd say in response.
Thanks. Other questions? I have other questions. kind of going back to the empty chair beside me. So your physical absence and your virtual presence is significant, as you talked about in the beginning. And I was in a broadening participation in computing community forum, like a virtual discussion recently, where we were discussing the challenges of holding conferences in certain states and cities with all this anti-trans and anti-DEIA legislation going on, period. And so I can imagine where you're gonna land on this, but I'll just bring up both sides, that there was an argument, you know, that as BPC organizations or as individuals who care about these issues, that we should boycott certain states and cities. And then there's a counter argument, or at least a consideration, right, about, well, what effect, if any, does that have on the folks in those places who are trans or who identify as a member of a queer community or another community that's being actively legislated against? So I'd be curious to hear what you have to say.
Yeah, I think that's a great question. First, I just want to point out too that, you know, whether any one of us as individuals goes to a place is a really personal choice. That doesn't necessarily mean private, right? I'm happy to be very transparent about why I didn't come. I don't want to put money into a state that has that vision of the future. It's not an investment I want to make, if we're okay with that metaphor. I would rather put my money into local organizations in Missouri that are creating the futures that they need. I'd rather put money into legal efforts to resist that legislation. I'd rather put money into the campaign of politicians who will take seats in the state legislature in Missouri that will create a different future than the one that the current legislature is imagining. Those are the kinds of things I'd rather invest in. And since I don't have infinite money, I'm putting the money there instead of at a hotel that just sort of amplifies the existing structures as they are. And so that's just the choice that I've made, is thinking about, where do I make my investments, and what futures is that money going to go to? And I'm not excited about investing in the status quo in Missouri. So that's not to say that your choice is wrong, right? There is value in being present in states. There is value in being visible. There's value in bringing messages to a place to show that there is discourse and community that is in support of different futures that we're trying to imagine. I think we just have to ask ourselves, how valuable are those things? How valuable is taking a community to a place and having a conversation? Especially, for example, if the people who need your support aren't in the room. I think that's a really important thing to think about too. And so, I don't know, I wrestle with this a lot, and it's hard. I've been a conference organizer too. It's hard to think about all of the different intersecting complexities of a physical place. You can't disentangle yourself from everything, but it does mean you have to think about what you do when you're there, what you do with the resources that you harness for it, and how much you live your values in what you do with those resources.
Yeah, thank you. Margaret has another comment. I also want to just say to all of you, like, I said questions, but you can also just enter the conversation.
Comments are
right?
Fine.
Yeah, comments are fine too.
Yeah, me again. yeah, okay. So I'd like to sort of add to this conversation, because lately it seems like, you know, a lot of conferences like NCWIT, like Grace Hopper, organizations like that have done a lot of soul searching about, you know, should we locate here, should we locate there? And you know, one side of the coin is exactly the viewpoint you expressed, Amy. And then the other side is, but that's where those people are needed. And so so that's kind of the other, yeah, the opposite thing, but kind of for the same reason. So like, for example, Grace Hopper was just down in Florida, which is, well, I shiver in my boots, but anyway. So I guess one thought that occurred to me about this back to the what can we do, is if anyone in here is a conference organizer of some sort and is considering having a conference in, you know, a place that has all these terrible laws, then maybe besides having a hybrid option, which NCWIT did, also have an optional add-on to the hybrid registration, in which you can pitch in, say, you know, $200 extra instead of your airfare, your hotel bill, or whatever, to various organizations that are fighting back, maybe your favorite politician in Missouri, or, you know, your favorite environmental organization if it's in Hawaii, or something like that. I don't know, just kind of a random brainstorm, but, you know, some of us are workshop organizers and conference organizers and might be in a position to pull something like that off. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a reasonable option that addresses some issues and doesn't address all of them, right? And at the collective level, I think that there are different solutions than there are at the individual level. Here's another example. There's every 2 years, the CRA Snowbird Conference, where lots of chairs and deans and other leaders in computing and information gather and talk about the future of academic computer science and research and the broader education mission that ties into all of that research too. I was invited to come this year. It's in Utah. It's always in Utah. That's just where it is. I can't legally pee in Utah. And so holding it in Utah means that I've spent at least 10 hours of my life for the past several months trying to decide whether or not I would do that, whether or not I would travel there. You're forcing people to have to wrestle with that work, and that's work that others don't have to do, don't have to think about, don't have to plan around. And so we're balancing here, right? The kind of collective things that we might do together with the individual kinds of harms that that we have to manage. And I decided to go. I think I can hold it from the airport all the way to the resort, maybe. Or maybe I'll just, you know, out myself with a t-shirt in the restroom and see if I can get arrested and then have a Supreme Court lawsuit take over my life for 5 years. I don't know which thing, right? That's the thing that I'm being forced to choose by holding it there. So how much do we weigh all of that kind of struggle against whatever impact our collective efforts might have? And that's the thing that I think organizers have to wrestle with.
Amy, this is Edie Cheng. Hi, and thank you again for this incredible talk and inspiration and speaking about stories that we need to hear. I did want to add, just for those of you who may not be in the session later, as part of working with Amy and with Wendy, we have also looked into some of those exact organizations here in Kansas City and in Missouri that are doing that heavy lifting of fighting for trans rights, because I think the act of inviting Amy and having this conversation about the reasons why she could participate virtually but not in person really did come to the heart of NCWIT's decision making, exactly as you said, Margaret. So we'll share more about that organization that we've identified to support later, but I think that this is such an important piece for us and as an organization and as a community to think about. So we just really appreciate having your voice as part of this conference in the way that was possible.
Yeah, I'm happy to share it. I don't have infinite energy to share, but I think this is an important place to make sure that's visible.
Yeah, thanks. I'm glad you brought that up, Edie, too, because you were instrumental in figuring out a way for Amy to be part of the summit. I have another question. You mentioned that what gives you hope are the students you have and the work you're doing. I wonder what you love most about the potential of computing for uplifting values of democracy and justice.
Yeah, this is something I wrestle with a lot intellectually and ethically, because the history of computing as a technology, as a discipline, is mostly one of profit and war. And so trying to wrestle with that history and think about, is there something about this medium that's intrinsically about profit and war? Or is it just historically, incidentally about those things? Can it also be about democracy? Can it also be about these other more pro-social things in the future? That's a big question that we talk about a lot in our pre-service program with teachers too. This is just something that's at the heart of their questions about whether they believe in teaching computer science at all, who they think it's for. Is it really just a project of helping youth get money and survive the capitalist systems that we live in? Or is it something that is actually more empowering and really is about building more just futures too? So here's where I've landed on that. This is just kind of where I currently sit, but this is always evolving. There is something particularly capitalist about a machine that is designed to do human things faster and without human participation. That's just a project of capitalism. I don't think that's an avoidable property of the system. That's kind of what it is. But there is also something about viewing computing in augmentation terms, in ways that enables us to do new things and say new things that we couldn't do before, that I also think is very much about empowerment and expression too. And so I like to lean into that side of it a lot more. And that's why, you know, back to Margaret's question about generative AI and large language models, I think a lot about applications of computing and art because of that. What does it help us say that we couldn't say before? Who does it help speak that couldn't speak before? Who does it give platforms to that didn't have a platform before? That stuff feels like at the heart of democracy. That's about what it means to share power together and to hear all voices and to try to find a way through our political conflicts in ways that serves everyone, not always just the majority, but really everyone. And then the capitalist parts that really try to erase people and erase human labor and do a lot of the other extractive and exploitative kinds of things, that's something to manage. And so I guess right now I'm kind of happiest with a world where people are making weird art with computing and then like actively resisting applications of computing towards, increasing income inequality. If you can do those two at the same time, I think maybe we're on the right track.
Nice, and we have another person in the audience.
Hello, thank you so much for your presentation. My name is Old Dues. I'm from Vancouver, Canada. And the good thing is we are not facing the same legislation that is here in US there, but we are seeing the impacts there on the mindset and how some of the EDI work is getting opposition. I wanted to start with two comments, and then I have a question. The first comment was, I agree with what you said about prisons and spending money on what you believe in. And when deciding, this is my first NC with Summit, and I was so excited to be here. But at the same time, when coming, I actually checked people I knew for different reasons. gender, racial, hijab, keffiyeh, the things that I have seen people wear advocating, and try to find out if they felt safe coming to this place. And like seeing you on the agenda was, like I was happy to see you there, and I'm really sorry that you couldn't come. So I think people pay attention to these things, and my second comment is, like, even though online presence and hybrid solutions are solutions, but they're halfway solutions. So I don't really like halfway solutions, and it would be best if we try to, like, actually design and plan things in a way that people can fully participate. Then my comment is, question is, we try to, in DEI programs and research, we try to address one, even though we try to make our solutions inclusive of all, in every single step we are taking, we actually try to solve the problem for one specific group. And sometimes that one step gets opposition because it's not inclusive, even though it is trying to go towards that direction. I'm assuming I'm not the only person who have seen this, and I was wondering if you have seen this and how would you approach it? Like, for example, if you are designing something for a specific equity-seeking group, you get the question of, what about this other group? And it might, like we usually say, the answer is usually helps everyone, but I'm like, when I'm starting the work, I'm not there yet to prove that it is, right? How can I get the support for my work when it's always opposed by the question of what if, what for the other group?
Yeah, well, there's a couple of challenges in what you've surfaced there. One of them is a political one. Sometimes people are asking about other groups because they don't actually value knowing about and supporting the group that you might have chosen to support. So this happens a lot. For example, my students will submit some research paper, will focus on the particular experiences of like Arab Black women in classes or something like that. And then we'll get a reviewer, almost certainly a white reviewer, that's like, well, what about the white girls? That's not what we were looking at. That's not what we're trying to understand. That's not what we're trying to learn about. And also nearly every other research paper is about white girls. So I think that there's a lot of room to talk about other girls in schools. And so those are the kinds of rhetorical games that we play in white supremacist culture is, well, we have to think about the majority too, otherwise your knowledge doesn't count. And so I think that's one challenge there. There is a different challenge, and I think this is one that's of more substance, one that's harder to kind of wrestle with how you would approach it. And that's, if you pick any particular dimension of identity, you're probably ignoring something important. Because we all have complex identities that interweave in challenging and unpredictable ways. No one can be reduced to any one dimension of identity. And so I think there is a benefit there in really looking to kind of the teachings of Black feminist thought and the way that Yolanda Rankin has thought a lot about how to bring that to computing education scholarship in trying to think about multi-marginalization and really understand how it plays out in the systems that we live in as a way of revealing the systems that we have and what their properties are and how they need to change. And then designing for multiple marginalization is a way to try to create systems that are not necessarily universal, but are certainly more universal than designing for any one particular facet of our experiences. So as an example of that from some of the stories that I shared would be things like, if you only focused on trans youth, you might make things marginally better from a bullying perspective for some of the youth in the stories that I shared, but that youth in a wheelchair that couldn't access the computer science lab in their school, they still wouldn't be able to take a computer science class. And it's actually their disability and the classroom spaces that make their disability a problem in the world, that's the bigger problem to that youth, not so much that they're trans. And so like you have to intersect things like that and really think about, well, how do we make a classroom that's safe for trans youth and accessible to people with disabilities? What does that project look like? And are there ways that those two interact in some way, where if you really are very visible and intentional about making a classroom accessible, does that also make more space for other kinds of diversity too? These are the questions that I think we should try to answer.
Thank you. Other comments on any of the topics that have come up or other questions? I have a page of questions here. I can keep going. Oh, we've got one.
Hi, Amy. It's Licia Barker, and thanks for your talk. Thanks for spending time with us today. I'm just wondering what resources you would recommend that NCWIT creates to make classrooms safer for everyone.
I'm wondering about the word resource. I think a lot about teachers these days and what teachers need to create those social spaces. And when I ask teachers, pre-service teachers, in-service teachers, what they need to make those classrooms safe, resources are part of the answer. But they really need time to learn, communities to grow together, time to grow practices, support for changing their practices, support for change. And they don't have any of those things. And so when I think about like the most critical things that they need to make those classroom spaces, it's not resources first that I think of. It's time and support and respect. So sometimes I wonder if, you know, our efforts would best be spent in our highly localized and distributed education system here, in our local spaces, in those local schools, trying to make sure that teachers have the capacity in their schools for change and for learning and for growth and support and respect so that they feel safe to take risks and try things with youth without feeling like they're gonna get 100 parents yelling at them and a school leader firing them. That's the kind of stuff that's in the way of change right now. And then when they have that capacity, those resources become essential because then they actually have time to read them and do something about them and grow in the direction that we're supporting them too. So yeah, I'm not anti-resource, but you know, I am pro capacity to be able to harness the resources. To answer the question, if there was capacity, what kinds of resources would need to exist there? I think there's a lot of cultural competency needed. Like Mickey Washington's really escalated visibility around that concept, but teachers in particular, but also school leaders who are really dictating things like whether to spend the money to elevate those desks or have some desks that are accessible to students with wheelchairs. All of the actors in school systems really have to understand human diversity. They have to be able to have enough competency around that to be able to understand and fight for and be motivated to solve all of those problems in schools. It's the absence of that knowledge that is the biggest barrier to change, and why some of these bills that make it illegal to have that knowledge are so problematic.
Yeah, education and awareness, right? We have another question or comment, I don't know.
Hi, Amy. My name is Sophia Mendoza. I work in the second largest school district in the nation, and one of my charges is bringing computer science at scale. And some of the researchers that you highlighted in your session today, I'm just so grateful that you highlighted, because I'm always in search of the most relevant research to bring to our educators in a way that is understandable for them to know the urgency of why computer science is so critical to our youth at this time and One of the researchers that you highlighted is Dr. Jean Rayu from UCLA, who's been a wonderful and amazing partner to my work. But I just wanted to say I'm cheering you on and just thank you so much for highlighting the other voices in your presentation today.
Yeah, and thank you for reinforcing the importance of that too. There are so many people doing such amazing things. So many people probably in the room that I can't see doing amazing things too. And that's the thing about doing collective action work like this, is that partly it's recognizing just the sheer possibility of a large number of people coming together with a shared mission. That's truly exciting. And I think that's something I've always admired about NCWIT and some of the other alliances, is just how we bring people together to do that work together. But also just recognizing that it's the diversity of that group that comes together that is its strength. It is, to me, the most wonderful thing, the most biggest privilege of being able to be a researcher at a university, is being able to bring together such different voices into my research space, to bounce off each other, all of the different perspectives about the world, the conversations that we have in our research meetings where somebody will pose some possibility and then somebody else will reshape it because they live in a different world, and somebody else will take that and invent something new from it. That's where the power of all of our action can come from. And then the question is how we stay together in that, because it's really easy for us to burn bridges with each other and not agree and let the conflict tear us apart in the exact same way that the GOP and the state legislature collapsed in beautiful form in the past several months in Missouri. They couldn't figure out how to work together, and so they didn't get anything done. Thank God.
Yeah, in that spirit, I want to invite folks in the audience, if you have either research that you have done or read about recently, or practices that you've enacted in your classrooms or in your communities that you think, you know, would be interesting to share and along the lines of what Amy has shared, please feel free to raise your hand and Edie will come around. We can always count on Margaret.
I really need to get over being so shy and retiring. Honestly, Wendy, it just almost sounded like an invitation, so I had to stand up. Yeah, of course, some of you already know we've been working on the approach we call GenderMag, which stands for Gender Inclusiveness Magnifier. And for many years, we concentrated on industry. It's a way, an inspection method for making the technology you build more inclusive. Anyway, but recently we've started something new with it. We've started integrating it into the classroom. And so we have, you know, well, I guess 4 new papers on it now. What we did is we took GenderMag, which is a method, and we smashed it on the floor into a million pieces and sprinkled it across the 4-year curriculum, CS curriculum, at Kane University, with the idea that if you teach students how to actually build more inclusive technology, that, you know, they wouldn't just become more aware of inclusivity, but actually have something actionable. And so we wanted students to feel like doing inclusive design was just part of CS, just part of what you do. So there was a crumb of it in every course, data structures and CS1 and, you know, databases and just everything. Anyway, so it turned out beyond our wildest dreams successful. We wrote a paper about it last summer and in TOS, ACM Transactions on Education, to talk about the results on the students. And so it did have, well, we eventually learned in another paper that students actually were building more inclusive technology. But for the classroom, what we published last summer is that the students loved it. They just loved it. And so they rated their instructors more highly than they had in previous years on creating an inclusive classroom. They rated each other more highly, so stuff about how things go on your team, you know, so much higher than it had been in previous years. And so it changed the climate. That's not actually what we were expecting. We just thought it was going to give students more capabilities in building more inclusive technology, but it also changed their thinking about how mainstream inclusivity is, and they valued each other more, and, you know, it was, like, awesome. Oh, and by the way, it helped with retention big time, too. So, yeah, so that's this practice, and all of our resources are publicly available for free and stuff like that, so, you know, gendermag.org.
Thank you, Margaret.
Others want to share? Doesn't have to be as full-blown as that. In terms of its development, that's what I meant.
Hi, I'm Ashley. I'm from Lehigh University. I've been sitting here kind of like thinking about the phrase universal design, and I've always felt like, well, kind of like what you were saying about, you have a research paper that's focused on Black women, so people are like, well, what about white women? And I understand the idea of universal design, but I've always felt like it has a little bit of that touch to it. Kind of like, let's make it palpable for everyone. And I understand if it benefits everyone, that's a good thing, but Margaret just used the term inclusive design. And I'm sitting here, I don't even know what my point is, I don't know what my question is, but I just wanted to at least comment on that, because I'm thinking about, you know, we had to focus on equality, and we're like, well, no, we should have a focus on equity, and we started talking about universal design. I'm wondering, in your spaces, is inclusive design more of a, I'm sorry, I'm getting over a cough, and this is not going well.
It's okay. It's going great. I'm getting the message.
Is that terminology that you're seeing being used more?
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Margaret just gave her something. I don't know what.
Yeah, I'm just passing drugs here.
Did you want to answer that?
A cough drug. I don't know who wants to answer it. Is it me or is it Amy or is? Amy, do you want it or shall I do it?
I'll say my piece. Let's talk about some of these words. We need words, but they get in the way sometimes too. So I think where our attention should be is on what is the world we are trying to create together. That's the question. That's the question we're always trying to answer. And sometimes we use words like inclusion, like equity, like equality, like universal, to try to signal what world we're trying to create. And I do think that those words have histories of particular visions of the future that we have to wrestle with. Things like inclusive usually means, let's take the world as it is and find all of the ways that it's not working for people and kind of patch things up so that it people feel safe enough to be in the world as it is. That's the general historical meaning of that word. And that's not a particularly radical vision of the future, right? That's mostly the future we have now, but a little less harmful. There are other words. I think equity is a pretty radical word, as much as we toss it around and don't really talk about what it means, but it actually means just making sure everybody has what they need to thrive, and then we can all argue about what thriving means. And anti-equity efforts are ones that take resources away from people who need them to thrive, and operate on the assumption that everybody, when they are born, has equal opportunity, equal rights, equal resources, none of which is true. And so that's a radical vision of the future, that if you need some resources, you might have them so that you can thrive in the same ways that others might too. Universal has always just felt a little bit like a lie to me, because nothing's universal. Nothing works equally well for everyone. We all actually have to wrestle with the fact that there are sometimes really severe incompatibilities between different needs in the world, and that we have to find ways of compromising around them. An accessibility example, for example, since universal design really stems from thinking about ability and disability, is really about things like captions. Captions are completely essential for deaf and hard of hearing audience members in a presentation. And they're absolutely distracting for many people with ADHD who are trying to listen to a speaker, but also pay attention to a constantly changing visual display of words that may or may not mirror what somebody's saying. You can't have that on or off and please everybody. You can try to imagine a different future where people maybe have captions that are private for themselves if they happen to need them. And then everybody has a device of their own to do that, but that means everybody has a device, which is not the world that we have either. And that means everybody has access to the internet, which is not the world that we have either too. And so, like, really it's the hard work of negotiating what future we want together and who's gonna be able to live in it. I don't know that universal is achievable, but compromise is achievable. Maybe that's not as exciting of a word, I think, not as inspiring of a word.
Yeah, thanks. I think we have one more, and we have time for one more, so it's perfect.
I actually have a question and also a comment. I would love to hear Margaret's thoughts on inclusive and universal design. But the other one is, so how do we approach design then? Amy mentioned, universal, there is nothing universal, right? So how do we approach design? Who do we... Again, I've been having the same problem, sorry. It's the mic.
Dry air in the conference center.
So who do we design for, how do we approach it? Do we design in a way where we're able to include the majority of the people, or do we design, how Patty was saying in the other session, I don't know if she is here, but do we design for the one person we, implicitly exclude all the time, right? The people who we do not even consider, right? So what would be the right way to go about it?
Yeah, well, I never like the word right, because that presumes that there's a solution, a correct idea, some, unequivocally good idea. There's a lot of different ideas, and they all have trade-offs. The one that I'm most fond of at the moment is Sasha Costanza-Schock's idea from Design Justice, and that's one where we really center specific communities and thinking about applications of computing and information and technology in communities. And that is inherently a message, I think, that is, in my interpretation, against scale. It's not about creating something that is for everyone on the planet and reaches everyone in a uniform way. It's something that says, well, there's this community organization down the street that has a particular need around computing, and we're going to empower them to design the thing that they need for themselves. And that's going to be a different thing than some for-profit company uses over on the side. It's not the world that we have now, right? The vision of computing is everything scales in a uniform way. Google makes the thing, everybody uses it. And whether or not you are a business, you are using Google Workspaces because it was designed for businesses. I think that's a really different kind of design, right? One that says, let's create one thing for everyone versus many things for everyone.
Thank you. So I will stand up so that I've been, you can't see me over there probably, but we are at time, and I just want us all to give Amy a hand, and or a clap, an applause, that kind of hand. And I appreciate all of you being in here. I appreciate Amy making this effort to deliver a talk in this way without being able to see you all. It's a challenging circumstance, but thank you all, and thanks, Amy.
Thanks so much, Wendy and everyone.
Thank you very much. And on to the next thing, which I believe might be lunch. Thank you.